The Bible says in Isaiah 65:21-22, they shall build houses. It's talking about heaven and the new earth. They will build houses. They will inhabit them. They will plant vineyards. They will eat the fruit of them. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For as the days of a tree are the days of my people, and mine elect shall long enjoy the works of their hands. You know, God is a creator, right? God is a creative being, and we are made in the image of God. We not only look like him, supposedly, but we have similar characteristics. And one of them that I think is really important is we're creative. We're not a creator, but we're creative. We can make things from other things. We can make plans and in this case, build houses. My wife and I have built 5 houses and remodeled 1. We're very tired of doing that. But when we get to heaven, you're not going to need a subcontractor. You're not going to need a contractor. You're not going to need an architect. You're going to have the skills to know how to do it yourself. You're going to have the energy to do it. You're going to live in the house instead of selling it. It's going to be amazing. And so the things that I find enjoyable in being creative, we're going to have the time, the energy, the materials, the know-how to do anything we want to do. It's going to be amazing. But we're talking about our country home. So this verse is talking specifically about that. There we'll build houses, inhabit the house that we build, we'll plant vineyards and eat the fruit thereof. I'm not going to build a house and you live in it or vice versa. We're going to do our own. It's going to be cool. We'll be able to design it and build it.
If there is one place that we all want to go, it's heaven. A place without death. A place of peace. It will be a place that we all live forever with our loved ones and with God.
Great Controversy says in page 645, children are born by heavenly angels to their mother's arms. Friends long separated by death are united, never more to part, and with the songs of gladness ascend together to the city of God. So when Jesus comes, the dead in Christ will rise first. Those that alive and remain will go together with Jesus to heaven. And we're going to take a journey in this presentation of what that might be like to travel to heaven and what heaven might be like. Revelation 19:5-7 says, a voice came out of the throne saying, praise our God, all ye servants, and ye that fear him, both small and great. And I heard, as it were, a voice of a great multitude, and as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of mighty thundering, saying, Alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife hath made herself ready.
Heaven is not within this universe. Many think that the throne of God is maybe on a different planet, and that the home of God's angels is maybe somewhere in another galaxy. But scripture shows that the location of God's heavenly throne is not on another planet or light years away at some other place in the universe. No, the Bible shows that God's domain of heaven is so far away that it's outside of this universe.
Now we're going to explore that concept of outside of our universe, and it's pretty neat. Ephesians 4:7-10 says, but unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Wherefore he saith, when he ascended up upon high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Now that he ascended up far above the heavens, that he might fill all things. So here we see that heaven is beyond what we see. For the Lord is high above the nations, and his glory is higher than the heavens. So when you look up in the sky, you couldn't see heaven, even if you had the latest telescope. As far as you can see, still you're not looking at heaven. It's way beyond that. Who can be compared to with the Lord our God, who is enthroned on high? He stops to look down on heaven and on earth. Psalms 133. By faith, we understand that the entire universe was formed at God's command, that what we now see did not come from anything that can be seen. So what we're seeing when we look in the sky is our universe, but God is beyond that. Heaven is beyond that.
The Bible describes the beginning of the universe when it records how God said, "Let there be light." When God said that, that was when he began the expansion of the universe into what you see today. There was a moment in time when God sparked the explosion of the universe. And the very fact that God was the one who sparked that explosion means that he himself is outside of the limits of that expansion. The very fact that God created the universe proves that he does not have to be contained within it.
Amos 5:8, "Seek him that maketh the seven stars and Orion, and turneth the shadow of death into morning, and maketh the day dark with night. He calleth from the waters of the sea, and poureth them out from the face of the earth. The Lord is his name." Notice Amos is specifically talking about one constellation, and that's Orion. Last Day Events talks about this on page 272. "Dark, heavy clouds came up and clashed against each other." It's talking about the beginning phase of the second coming. "The atmosphere parted and rolled back. Then we could look up through the open space of Orion, whence come the voice of God." So God is going to come through the open space in Orion. Now, she specifically calls it an open space. So that would imply that the rest is not open.
Jesus, at the time of the second coming, will step out of the most holy place. He will begin to come back to the earth. Of course, Jesus leaving the New Jerusalem there, coming through the open space in Orion. There's the trapezium now. As you exit Orion, that great bowl configuration surrounding Jesus on his return will, of course, be millions and millions of angels surrounding him. Of course, as Jesus himself speeds toward the earth at thousands of times the speed of light, he will have to slow down as he approaches the earth. Coming through the solar system, he passes the sun, of course, doing many times the speed of light until he gets close to the earth, slows down. The people on the earth will first see a dark cloud. And as that dark cloud gets a little closer, a little brighter, and it finally lights up the sky. And as it lights up the sky, those people who are alive and waiting for Jesus will welcome him. They'll say, "Lo, here is our God. We have waited for him." In Revelation 14:12, "Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus."
Now, thinking about this open space in Orion, I have a theory. If there is an open space in what we see and it's Orion's belt, then what would that be like? And I saw a movie, animated movie one time. I think it was called Ants or something like that. And the whole plot was they were underground in these colonies, and this one rebellious ant wanted to go beyond what he knew. And they all thought he was crazy and you're going to die and everything. And he, at the end of the movie, he pops out of the ground and realizes there's a whole huge earth. He's in a park in the grass. And it's like, wow, who would have guessed this was here? So that's how I picture it. Here's another analogy. You take a basketball and there's a valve where you put the air in. If the open space in Orion is like the valve on a basketball, we're inside the basketball. And everything we see in the sky is the inside of the outer skin of the basketball. But there's a valve, and when you go through it, it's way bigger, and we can't see any of it. So that's my theory. We'll see when Jesus comes through there. Now, when that happens, we end up in heaven, and we have the New Jerusalem. And anybody know how big it is? Huh? 300 miles. Yeah, well, it's at least 300 miles. Here's how big it is, according to one person's theory. This is the North America. So it's over half the size of the United States. And it's square, right? But it's also a cube. So it's as high as it is wide and as wide as it is tall. So can you picture a city with walls that are 300 miles high, or maybe 2,000 in this particular illustration? You will see later that some other people picture it as there's a mountain in the middle, Mount Zion, I guess, and that's the height. But I kind of think it's square. And I thought, how would you do a city that was square that would be that big? But imagine if it's made out of clear glass, and each layer has its own atmosphere, and you could have full-grown trees, and you could have everything you're seeing here in one floor of the New Jerusalem. So that's my imagination again. So this, I believe, is a Nathan Green Adventist artist rendition of the Second Coming. And it's quite accurate, because oftentimes we see angels as female, but the Bible basically always calls them male, if there is even a gender. But anyway, this is a picture of Jesus coming and the resurrection. And we all want to be there. So now let's focus on our country home after that. So we have looked at the belt of Orion and the Jesus voice, God's voice going to come through that at the second coming. And then God's going to come, the second coming of Jesus will be through that with the angels and everything. And that it may very well be that what we see is inside what's really all out there. We know from the spirit of prophecy that there are other worlds that God has created that are like us. I don't know that they're in the image of God, but there are other beings who have not fallen. They have the tree of the knowledge of good and evil and have chosen not to eat from it. I would think that we were the first one to do it, but that, why would God stop creating just because we messed up? So somewhere in the spirit of prophecy, it talks about going back to heaven, and it's gonna take, anybody know how long? 7 days. And what are we gonna do for 7 days? Huh? I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you. Sightsee. We're going to sightsee, yeah. That's going to be a lot further than Orion, I'm pretty sure. And we're going to visit some of these planets that have other unfallen beings. And I think she even says we're going to spend Sabbath on one of those. That'd be cool.
I think we're also going to be interested in meeting our family that we've never met.
For sure. Yeah, meeting the family you never met. Yeah, it'll be great. Yeah, a big camp meeting. Because they're all the family of God, right? We just happen to be the black sheep. Revelation 21, now I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away. Notice the first heaven passed away. That would be what we can see, I think. Also, there is no more sea. Then I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of from heaven from God, prepared like a bride adorned for her husband. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Let me pause right there. Those of you that know me know I'm a weeper sometimes, like my friend Jeff Rowland. And I guess that's okay. I just hope I don't have a stroke, because those people do it a lot. When I have a stroke, I'm going to be bald all the time. Oh, my. Help us. But notice it says God will wipe every tear from their eyes. And I always thought that meant, oh, I can't wait to go to heaven. There won't be any more death, no more tears, no more crying. This isn't talking about that. This is talking about after we've been in heaven for 1,000 years and we're coming down to the new earth. Then there will be no more tears and crying and death and so forth. Now, there won't be death in heaven, but there's going to be death because the wicked are going to get consumed, right? And Satan and the evil angels. So I'm wondering if, will we be tear-free in heaven? And I think we may not, because we're going to be saying, why didn't my loved one make it here? We'll see. It's good, yeah. When Christ watches the wicked getting consumed once and for all, I'm sure he'll be weeping. There'll be no more pain. The former things have passed away. Then he who sat on the throne said, behold, I make all things new. Revelation 21. Isaiah 32 and 60. My people shall dwell in a peaceful habitation and in sure dwellings and in quiet resting places. Now notice talking about where they're going to dwell. It's where's their house? Peaceful habitation, like the birds singing and the beautiful scenery here. Violence will be no more heard in the land, wasting or destruction within the borders. But thou shalt call thy walls salvation and her gates praise. Isaiah 35 and 55. The wilderness and solitary place will be glad for them. The desert will rejoice. The blossom as the rose. Instead of thorns will come up the fir tree. Instead of the briar will come up the myrtle tree. So we won't have any thorns. We won't have any poisonous plants or animals threatening anybody or any other being. You know, there's a lot of places, especially in the Psalms, where you hear about the trees wave and praising the Lord and the animals and this and that. I've often wondered whether when we get to heaven and the new earth, whether actually animals will and nature will praise the Lord, or whether that's a metaphor. I don't know the answer to that. Isaiah 11, the wolf shall dwell with the lamb and the leopard will lie down with the kid and the calf and the young lion and the fatling together and the little child shall lead them. They shall not hurt or destroy in all my holy mountain. Revelation 22, and he showed me a pure river, water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. Now notice, it's coming from the throne of God. In the midst of the street of it, okay, so the water's coming down the middle of the street, and on either side of the river, so there, it's a river, there was a tree of life, which bare 12 manners of fruit, and yielded her fruit every month. And if you didn't know, Fritos is going to be one of those fruits, I think, for haystacks, right? And the leaves of the tree will be for the healings of the nations. And there shall be no more curse, but the throne of God and the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. The tree of life, in another place here, is on both sides of the river. And then when he looked closer, it joined up at the top and became one tree. Kind of cool. So then here's the verse we started with, Isaiah 65. They will build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat of the fruit of them. They shall not build and another inhabit. They will not plant and another eat. For as the days of the tree are the days of my people, and mine elect shall long enjoy the works of their hands. There are some Old Testament times where the people were given a glimpse of what heaven would be like, such as Isaiah. And in the New Testament, we have glimpses of heaven, like through John, the last book of the Bible, and Revelation. What we're going to do is try to understand how big it is, how far it is to get to Orion, how big our universe is. You know, we know that it takes time for a spacecraft to go to the moon and humans to get there. We know they're trying to get to Mars. They've got a spacecraft that circled Mars and took pictures, but they haven't got a human there yet. Elon Musk is thinking we need to get to Mars because the Earth's going to destroy itself and we need to start a new civilization on Mars. I remember when I was a kid, my mom would say, well, God is never going to let man get to the moon, because that would spread sin to another planet. And then man landed on the moon in 1969, supposedly anyway. And she also said there weren't any dinosaurs, and then we found all the bones. But anyway, this is showing the distance from the sun through our immediate solar system, okay? So the question is, how far is Orion? So we're going to do a little exercise here. Okay, now it is 238,000 miles to go from Earth to the moon. 238,000, okay? And 200, if you skip to the third section, 38,000 miles is to go around the world. If you went on a plane around the world or on a boat, it'd be 25,000 miles. So the distance from here to the moon is 10 times around the Earth, okay? That's a long ways. So we're going to crunch this down into something we can make a little more manageable. Let's say that the moon is one step. Now, then, by comparison, if Jupiter, which is the next closest, it would be a little less than going down this driveway and turning around, like at the gate, and turning around and coming back. Compared to the moon to the Earth, it's 3 feet. You would walk all the way down there, go to the gate, and come back. Okay, that's Jupiter. Mercury is the next one. You would go to the end of the driveway, past the gate, and come back. Saturn, now they're kind of different directions, so they're not overlapping, but Saturn is 2,600 feet at that scale, which means it would be farther than going to the pavement and back. It'd be farther, okay? Neptune, you'd go all the way to State Highway 9 in distance, okay? And we're still not out of our solar system. So what about the Belt of Orion? It is 252 light years from the Earth. How long is a light year? How far? How fast is a light year? How fast does light travel? 186,000 miles a second. 186,000 miles a second. Okay? And things are so far out in space that they measure in light years. Okay? So there's 186,000 miles per second. And I calculated that's 300 million seconds in a year. 300 million. And so when they say a light year, they're talking 300 million seconds worth of travel at 186,000 miles a second. That calculates to 2, Mr. Scientist, E21, is it to the power? Is that what, how do you say that? Times 10 to the power? Yeah. So now, kids, I need to see what you know about these numbers. 2000000000. What does it mean if it's 2000? What would you call that? 2000. Very good. 1000. What if you add 3 more zeros? What's the next step in 1000? Million. Very good. And A million is a thousand thousands. It's way big, okay? What about three sets of zeros? A billion. Good, a billion with a B. What about four sets? Am I saying this right? Four sets of zeros. What would that, you got a thousand, million, billion, trillion, quadrillion, pentillion, sextillion. So 2 sextillion miles from Earth is the Belt of Orion. That's that big number there. That's a long, long, long ways. Daniel, this blows me away. Some of you heard me talk about this often. Daniel was praying. I thought it was when he, the lion's den story, but it wasn't. It was another time when he was praying for Israel and asking for forgiveness of their sins and stuff like that. But Daniel was praying and God in heaven told Gabriel to go from heaven to Daniel's side and comfort him and give him the vision or whatever he did. Can you imagine being able to travel so fast, so far? We don't even know how far heaven is. We know that Orion is a long ways away, 2 septillion miles. Daniel was able to have Gabriel, before he got off his knees, stand next to him from heaven. I have a theory. You know, Adam and Eve were made in the image of God. And when man sinned, we lost some of our capabilities because God just couldn't entrust so much power and privilege to fallen man. How many senses do we have? 5. Taste, touch, feel, etc. I think we might have had 6 when we were created, and that had to do with, well, maybe 7. That's a good number. If there's 7, it might be that we can communicate without talking. Have you ever heard of déjà vu? Déjà vu is, you know, I've seen this whole thing before. Somewhere in my past, we were at this camp meeting, and I remember you. You know, that's déjà vu. I don't remember you from this place in the past, but that's what déjà vu is. Or, you know, mental telepathy, you want to move, whatever. You know, there, some of that stuff's probably the devil. But I think that when we are recreated new, we're going to have capabilities we currently don't have. And one of those is going to be travel. Many of you know I'm a car guy, and I did a sermon one time to a bunch of car guy Adventists in our Adventist Rodders Club, and the title of the sermon was, if there aren't 32 Fords in heaven, I'm not sure I want to go. And that was tongue-in-cheek, but, you know, we're not going to have cars. We're not going to have planes. We're not going to have spacecraft. We're not going to need it. We're not going to need it. We can just fly there. Why wouldn't we be able to travel as fast as Gabriel? That's pretty fast. You're not going to need a car. Did you have a comment? No? Okay. All right. Well, anyway, we won't know all these things until we get to heaven, but it's going to be amazing. Eye hath not seen nor ear heard what we're going to see when we get there. So now while I was speaking, praying, and confessing my sin, this is Daniel talking, and the sin of thy people Israel, presenting my supplication before the Lord, my God of the holy mountain, my God, so he's up on the holy mountain in New Jerusalem. Yes, while I was speaking in prayer, the man Gabriel, whom I had seen in vision at the beginning, being caused to fly swiftly, reaching me about the time of the evening offering. And he informed me and talked to me. So he was in heaven, says at the holy mountain, and the man Gabriel, who I'd seen in vision, being caused to fly swiftly. Man, that's fast. Okay, whoops, hit the wrong button. So this is really cool. We showed this at camp meeting during this stargazing event, had it on a big screen. I discovered this on the internet, and it was a father and son. They are both doctors, Adventist doctors, and Dave Gentry and Robert Gentry. And they took a million star positions and magnitudes using the Yale Star Database, And they created a computer animation of how it would be to travel to heaven through the Belt of Orion. And they actually show the Belt of Orion. So they're going to do this journey. And it was presented at the 3ABN 10 Commandment event in Washington, D.C. in 2006. And so was that thing we saw about the Second Coming. That's why there were people applauding, because it was at that event.
Suppose indeed we want to go through the Orion Nebula and go to the throne of God. Here we go.
As we are leaving the Earth here. And of course we'll pass the Earth. We see the sun there to our right. Now approaching the sun. And you can see the Orion Nebula there past the sun. As we pass the sun, we're probably going over 100 times the speed of light. And approaching Orion, the individual stars will be passing at different times because they're at different distances from the Earth. But it's actually in the sword of Orion. The middle star of the sword of Orion is the Orion Nebula. We're approaching it here. Coming closer, coming closer. The Orion Nebula is 1,500 light years from the Earth. That cavern is actually 100 light years wide. You go into the center of that cavern. We're circling around the trapezium cluster here. This is actually something you can see with a home telescope if you're interested in looking at it. You won't see the nebulosity, but you will see the trapezium. Going through the trapezium, continuing past the trapezium as we come to heaven, to the city of New Jerusalem with the foundations of precious stones, the gates of pearl. Approaching now to the temple in the New Jerusalem.
The sanctuary. And as we go to the sanctuary, what are we going to end up with? There is indeed right before us Christ the great high priest.
And the Ten Commandments.
And the Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments.
Notice their rendition of the New Jerusalem is not a cube, but it is as high as it is wide, but it happens to be a mountain. So we'll find out when we get there. The angel of the Lord encamps around about them who fear him and delivers them. This was my mom's favorite picture. Notice the angel is a female in this case. But, you know, I'm looking forward to meeting my guardian angel. I had a young friend years ago who named his guardian angel, and he would talk to him. He didn't hear back, but but he just treated him like his buddy, you know. But we all know that we have a guardian angel. Each one of us have a guardian angel. And I'm looking forward to finding out the times that that guardian angel went to bat for me when I didn't even know it happened. And we know instances in our lives when we were protected and we give God the credit. But there are probably untold numbers of times when we were protected when we didn't even know. So I'm looking forward to getting to know my guardian angels. I'm looking forward to meeting some of these matriarchs and patriarchs in the Bible. Most of all, I want to see Jesus.